Thank you very much for coming as BCC is celebrating Earth Day. Isn't that great? And I want to begin by applauding all of our tables and all of the vendors that have come and people that are promoting environmentalism and greenness in the community. It's very good for these. We couldn't do it without these volunteers who come and make this day a terrific day. You know, something that I've always maintained that about higher education and our institutions in higher education is that we must have a twofold mission about environmentalism and about sustainability. And that is, we have a duty as an educational institution, we have a duty to inform the community, to make known the importance of sustainability. And that is an ongoing effort, such day, events such as Earth Day today. And that's our duty. I mean, that's our mission, is to educate, right? So we must make clear to the community and the region and the state and the nation and the globe the importance of sustainability. But that's not enough. That's only one part of our mission, because it's one thing to tell people what they should do or what they should not do or whatever it is, but it's another very important part of our mission to model what we're saying, to model our own educational efforts. And we want to serve as an example of the benefits of the things that we're talking about. We want to show the ROI, you know what that is, the return on investment, that sometimes in this business-oriented global world, sustainability gets a little short shrift. But it is a very important part of the economy, the global economy. It brings back to the benefits in ROI, return on investment, when you invest in the sustainability efforts. And Bristol Community College, therefore, taking advantage of that twofold mission, to inform, to educate, but also to demonstrate. And that's our mission, and that's what we do. We love it, and it's great to be at BCC to do this. Now, on your way in today, speaking of demonstrations, on your way in today, you drove by, most of you anyway, our solar canopy. Our solar canopy. Governor Baker came. Thank you. Governor Baker came and to dedicate the canopy 2 years ago, a year ago, July, August, and 3.2 megawatt solar array covering over 5 acres. It provides for us 70% of the electricity at the campus. And that's amazing. As you look at the other buildings, we have 11 buildings at the campus, at this campus, we have solar panels on most of the roofs to provide, again, sustainability efforts for us. We have created at the college, again, demonstrating our commitment, an institute for post-carbon and for sustainability and post-carbon education. And Professor Nancy Lee Wood has been a great leader in this regard. Professor Jim Corvin, whom you've met here somewhere, and we wouldn't have Earth Day without Professor Corvin's great work. So it's our Institute for Sustainability and Post-Carbon Education came as a result of a presidential fellowship. So the college is supporting this effort. Years ago, I was one of the original founding signatories, if you will, for the American College and University President's Climate Commitment, a national group. We were one of the few community colleges at the time. And I signed that, and I still serve on the board of directors It's now become Second Nature is the name of the group as it evolved, but it's still committed to by 2050, 25-0, being carbon neutral and with various milestones from now until then that the college commitment requires us to meet. And we happily entered into that commitment so that we show our demonstration of what we feel is very important for an educational institution. So the national group is represented here. We have the institute here at the college. We have the solar canopy that I've mentioned to you. We have also across the street from the solar panel canopy is the new health and science building. And that new building is zero net energy. And it replaces all the energy that it uses. It's platinum LEED certified, and it has won a number of awards in international, national, and local state awards for its unique design and its sustainability commitment in making that design. And a lot of the awards have come from architectural organizations and environmental organizations recognizing the value of what we do. It stands out as a model in the state and in New England. It's the only building of its kind for that size, 46,000 square feet. It's the only building of its size for in the north, not just New England. And it doesn't come at an easy through easy efforts. The college has really committed to it, so I'm very, very proud about that. We received a $600,000 grant from DOER, the state department division, to put in the geothermal system under the new building that helped bring that zero net energy about. We received a state award for a comprehensive approach to clean energy and environmental impact of norms of campus operations. Energy and Water Conservation Improvement Project included a $4.9 million project that reduced our water consumption by 47% at the college and building energy consumption by 24% annually. Very proud of that. We have a wind turbine just north of the parking lot, and it is rated at 6 kilowatts. We had planned a bigger one, but it didn't, you know, there are, we have a community commitment, and some of the neighbors were very nervous about a huge turbine, and I told them that in 15 years, they're all going to have one in their backyard. But they can't stand to have it, you know, on the campus. So as we have a smaller one, but we want, again, demonstrate the importance of wind power. It's rated at 6 kilowatts, as I mentioned. We're also, speaking of wind, we're also, BCC is also very prominent player, the lead training institution connected with the entire wind power effort in New Bedford, off the coast of New Bedford, and that is one of the largest wind farms, if that's the right word, resources in the world. It's like the people have called it the Saudi Arabia of wind. So we're uniquely positioned in southeastern Massachusetts to take advantage of this great, great resource. We have a solar hot water system in the roof of our enrollment center right up here in this building, and will reduce the need to run a gas-fired domestic hot water boiler for all of the hot water demands in the building. And the system consists of 18 collectors, reducing emissions by 2 tons of CO2. 2 tons being reduced at a cost saving expected at almost $3,000. So we continue to, whether it's a large solar canopy, we have new water bottle filling stations, whether it's a large project or a smaller project, it all helps. We have recycling, as you know, is part of our culture. The lawn and the leaf debris, it contributes to our, the way we use them, contributes to our sustainability commitment. Cooking oil from the culinary arts program and our food services is collected and recycled through a partnership with Newport Biodiesel. There's just no end to it. And I could go on and on. I have pages and pages of these things, but I did want, and it fits our theme of Earth Day, all right? But again, I think my important point to you are the twofold, is the twofold part of our mission with regard to sustainability, to inform, to educate on the one hand, to demonstrate and serve as a model on the other. And I want to thank all the people at BCC and our BCC family who have come together to provide this great, great effort. And now we want to get to the our main event here. Our keynote speaker, Martin Suuberg, is the commissioner of the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection. He was appointed to that position in 2015 by Governor Charlie Baker. But he has been in the Environmental Protection Department for almost 20 years, and he has nearly 30 years of experience in the field. So we really have an expert to talk to us today on this theme. He is just wonderful to give of his time and to be with us today. I know he has to run for Boston shortly after he finishes, but very good of him to fit us into his schedule on the importance of Earth Day. And I thank you all for coming as well. So please, let me introduce Commissioner Suuberg.
Thank you so much for this opportunity, President Sbrega. Professor Corvin, thank you for the invitation. It is just a delight to be here, not only because of the program, but also to just hear all of the amazing things that are going on in this room, the people that represent sustainable agriculture, solar energy, advocacy for clean energy, environmental justice, a number of concerns that really touch on what we do in this agency. It's an impressive turnout. You are all very important parts of the ongoing discussion that is so critical for us to have in the Commonwealth. I loved hearing about the recitation of the projects, the almost 5 acres of solar panels. What an impressive project. I was pleased to be with Joe, your director of facilities. He was taking me through all the recycling efforts, which I so applaud you for. I'll have more to say on that in a moment. Just the commitment to a sustainable lifestyle, recognizing that environmental protection is also the protection of public health, and it's also good sense. It's good business. When we make the right decisions, it truly is a win-win-win in so many areas. So the work you're doing, as you've indicated, to both inform and to demonstrate is vitally important. I'm really glad to be celebrating Earth Day with you because in doing that, we spend a little bit of time looking back on the progress we've made, which is important because it reminds us nothing succeeds like success, and it's a template for us going forward. But it's also an important reminder for us to rededicate ourselves to the work that has to be done. And I cannot think of a better place to be at to do that. I am old enough to remember the first Earth Day. I remember it very well, which gives you an idea of how old I am. But it really was a signal event at the time and continues to be. It's ongoing relevance to our society. But in that day, when it started in the early 70s, it ushered in a really important era of environmental legislation, and more than legislation, environmental action. Many of us can remember what we were seeing in the late 60s and early 70s in terms of air pollution, smog. Smog was not just in Los Angeles, smog was everywhere. We remember what the impacts to water bodies. There are some people in DEP, my agency, who, when they started this work, they started, you know, as a result of the challenge, you know, of Earth Day. They literally tell stories about how they remember rivers running different colors based on the industrial processes that were discharging. They remember the loss of wetlands. They remember the loss of farmlands. There was a variety of things that were going on, and again, with a concerted commitment by government, by really society writ large to make sure we were addressing these issues, things started to change. And while we've made tremendous progress, there's still more to do. As we know, there are new challenges. Science tells us new things, not only about climate change, which I'll spend a bit talking about, but about other media that we are worried about, be it water, be it safe lands, be it any number of environmental indicators. I've talked a little bit about my age, and I'll say one other thing about it. I've been at this for almost 35 years professionally. I've been alive a little longer than that. But one thing I've learned is we're all in this together. Big problems generally get solved when all parts of society are working together. Government, academia, citizen advocates, nonprofits, the business community, when we all have done work to identify a problem and to start working on solutions, we can do great things. As I indicated with past work on environmental issues, and our society has rightfully come to expect clean air, clean water, safe land, and we all play a role in working to preserve our public health and environment. At the state level, I think we've recognized the importance of working together. Breaking down silos, as they sometimes talk about it in business and organizational terms. We, in our own work, we are now partners with the agencies that work on energy issues, recognizing that environmental protection and clean energy are really two sides of the same coin, recognizing that siting of energy issues have environmental impacts that we need to address. When we look upon climate change, we also recognize that this is not just an environmental issue. It ends up being a public safety issue, too. We've seen all too often lately the impact of severe weather events. We've seen the scientific evidence of climate change and recognize that we all need to plan for the future when dealing with it, on both how to mitigate the impact, how to mitigate the emissions we're putting into the atmosphere, as well as dealing and preparing, developing a resilient society going forward. That's why I'm glad to be here with you. A state agency like DEP benefits from scientific work done at institutions like yours. This place is a laboratory for a number of important efforts. The men and women who graduate and who hopefully will come, if not to work in our agency, but maybe work in other fields with our agencies or in other pursuits that promote the understanding of public health and the environment, you really are our future. Campuses are places where people organize for their voices to be heard and rally for action on issues they care about. In the academic environment, we can experiment, see what we learn, what works well, what doesn't, what needs to be adjusted, and bring about new ideas and new approaches. You understand the power of new technologies and how to use them. Massachusetts has had a proud history of protecting public health and the environment. Our state legislature in those early years passed its own Clean Water Act, its own Clean Air Act. Public health laws designed to protect communities. It was one of the states that passed a Wetlands Protection Act in the 1970s, recognizing the unique value that wetlands play in protecting water resources, a program that has continued to benefit the Commonwealth throughout. Mass DEP is the recipient of a legacy. We are the home to one of the oldest public health and environmental labs in the nation. Our Wall Experiment Station in Lawrence has over 120 years of doing innovative work on public health, of helping to certify laboratories to make sure they're adhering to the highest standards, and a number of other functions. Our community and our Commonwealth more recently took bold action on the growing issues surrounding climate change. In the late 2000s, 2007, 2008, the Commonwealth, its legislature passed the Global Warming Solutions Act, setting targets for reducing emissions of greenhouse gas by 2020. We have to reduce them by 25% by 2020 and 80% by 2050. And the Green Communities Act, which was designed to help cities and towns invest in clean energy. We are part of a multiple multi-state initiatives. We work together with other states in the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, an innovative program of 9 states that have gotten together to cap greenhouse gas emissions and have basically used the proceeds from auctions that are part of that process to reinvest in energy efficiency. The Commonwealth, since we joined this program in the mid-2000s, has received over $306 million in energy efficiency investments, which has translated into several times more than that in terms of saved electric bills and greater efficiency. Our work with those 9 states continues. We are also part of multi-state efforts to make sure that we are continuing to follow the best science on fuel-efficient automobiles and promoting electric vehicles around the nation. We have a commitment. We're part of 8 states that have committed to having 300,000 electric vehicles on the road by 2025. And working with our partner agencies, we're making sure we're creating the right incentives. We at DEP have a program that works with municipalities to help them make the investment in electric vehicles and the infrastructure, the charging stations we need. Our colleagues in the Department of Energy Resources are making commitments to make sure that we are thinking strategically with our transportation partners about where we need the infrastructure so people that use electric vehicles can know that they can reliably get from point A to point B in our region and know that there will always be a charging station and facilities they need to make sure that they have a safe and convenient trip. I understand there are some nice vehicles out there. I'm dying to take a drive on some of them. They don't always let me do that, but there are some great electric vehicles, I understand, out in the parking lot. We are continuing to make progress on innovative energy. As I indicated, I'm delighted to see all of our solar representatives here. Our governor passed a clean energy bill in September of 2016, which ups the commitment that the Commonwealth is making to procuring clean sources of energy, both now and going forward, again, to make sure that we're meeting our clean energy goals. In addition to that, there's still a lot to be done. And I'm just going to highlight a few of the things that we're working on. In 2017, we as a Commonwealth remain committed to doing the work on climate change. Our governor passed an executive order, 569. And again, a lot of times I'm talking about legislation, I'm talking about executive orders. Sometimes it sounds very bureaucratic. I'm an agency like DEP. We talk in lots of acronyms. But behind those acronyms are requirements and deadlines and milestones for action. And Executive Order 569 is one of the more important ones that we're operating under. It sets aggressive timelines for my agency to develop new rules to limit the emissions of greenhouse gases in the Commonwealth. There are 6 sets of rules that are out and under consideration right now. We put them out for public comment in December. We have to finalize them by August. It will. It proposes additional reductions for the power sector. It requires the state to lead by example in terms of reducing the emissions from its own fleet. It tries to incentivize the work in other sectors to make sure that we are continuing to get reductions not only in the power sector, but the transportation sector, which, as we know, is a very important part of our economy and where we're getting a lot of the greenhouse gas emissions. We have a lot of work to do, but by August of 2017, we plan to have these rules on the book to help make sure we're meeting our greenhouse gas reduction targets. The other thing the executive order does is it not only talks about limiting what we put up into the atmosphere, it also talks about us preparing for the future, for the effects of climate change. Our secretary has been tasked by the governor to co-lead an effort with the Secretary of Public Safety and other cabinet officers to really take a broader look at how we're prepared to make sure that, again, we are working across government, because climate change is not just an environmental issue. It is a public safety issue. It is a preparedness issue. as I've said, we've seen the impacts already of severe weather events and how it can disrupt the transportation sector, how it can disrupt other sectors. We need to start working on making sure that we have thoughtful, forward-looking plans. So again, our Secretary of Environment and Energy, the Secretary of Public Safety, are working right now with a number of agencies to develop a climate adaptation report, which will help guide government's response to climate change going forward and making sure that our programs are working in harmony. We will continue to work, in addition to the issues of climate change, we will continue to work on other issues related to air quality. We've spent an awful lot of time talking about carbon emissions and greenhouse gases, but there's a lot of work that DEP does with regard to other air quality issues. Ozone remains a big issue for this region. We need to make sure that we are continuing to make progress. Again, we are part of a multi-state effort. The federal government, EPA, has set a new protective health standard, a new more protective health standard. We will need to be working both in our state and with other states to make sure that we are confronting this issue. There are a number of parameters that we look at with regards to particulate matter, nitrogen oxide, and other issues that we're going to continue to be working on. Water will also be a big issue for our agency moving forward, as it is for my colleagues around the nation. But as we know from the Flint situation, the imperative of making sure that we are protecting our public water supplies has never been more important. We are very lucky in this state, and I am very lucky to work with them. We have a dedicated group of people in our drinking water programs throughout Massachusetts DEP who have made it a point of making sure that all of our public water systems are working with them, but to make sure that they're in compliance with all of the requirements. It is a very labor-intensive exercise. It is not only a system of inspections, it is a system of reviewing reports, ongoing monitoring data when there are problems, working with communities to make sure they're addressing problems. It is an ongoing job, and again, it is becoming more important, not only because of the issues of lead, but because of other emerging contaminants that science is telling us that we need to pay attention to. At this point, I also do want to acknowledge one of those people working on that issue is the regional director of our Lakeville office, which serves this community, Millie Garcia Serrano, who is here in the second row. Millie works with a tremendous group of professional men and women, who many of whom are long tenured and have great expertise in working on these issues. In addition to drinking water, water resources remains a very important issue for our agency. We are continuing to make sure that we have an accurate assessment of how water quality is measured and how we are doing in the Commonwealth. There is an ongoing growth of attention not only to discharges from conventional sources like treatment plants that we think of, but also how we're managing stormwater, how we're dealing with runoff. We are continuing to make sure that we are going to be actively engaged in that work, and that we are continuing to make progress on that. I'm very sorry that I won't be here. I know Professor Zach is going to be talking later about water technology issues. I wish I could stay and hear it, but hopefully, Millie, let me know what he says. But that it's a very timely topic, and I'm glad the institution is looking on it. And again, in working on water, one of the things I really want to highlight, I use this word all the time in this role, and I really mean it, it's partnerships. We will do our best work when we are partners with our cities and towns that do so much to manage water resources, with academia, with advocacy groups that spend their time and effort on their own time and their own effort, I should clarify, people that care about their watersheds, people that understand the connections. We are constantly at DEP trying to make sure that we are understanding and taking advantage of the connections we can make with people that care about the same things we do in terms of water quality. This is not only an issue that is timely, but we recognize that we will enhance our understanding by making sure we understand the local perspective. We do this we're trying to make sure we're doing this in all types of environments. Traditionally, when people think about the environment, they might think of a nice view like I keep turning to out here, a nice water body in the woods. But there are urban environments that we need to make sure we're paying attention to. We need to make sure that we are working in those areas to make sure that we are addressing the issues that urban environments face, be it illegal dumping, be it air quality impacts from facilities in those areas. We need to make sure that that dialogue is ongoing too. And so we are working to make sure that we are continuing to be engaged in those communities as well. We will be working to promote other policies that will help us manage our waste. Again, I'm always so pleased to go over and see how the recycling efforts in any given agency or any given institution are going. I'm thrilled to see the commitment to recycling here. That's work that our agency will continue to try to promote. We have aggressive goals through 2020 to take things out of landfills, to take things out of incinerators, and find productive reuse of them. It's not too soon to start thinking about 2030. We are beginning our planning effort for 2030 to think about how we further reduce our goal beyond the 46% that we've set for ourselves by 2020 and increase that goal, keeping things out of the landfills and keeping things out of the incinerators. Thank you. So with this work, I'll end a little bit on two themes again, and one of them I think very much right in line with what we heard the president talk about, and very much right in line with how we're seeing things at DEP. First of all, the theme of partnership is absolutely essential. We do better when we work together. And then secondly, the goal and what you institutions bring. Again, the new ideas, the new understanding of technology, the willingness to innovate in an environment like this is absolutely essential. I am hoping that we can find partnerships and new opportunities in the field of stormwater, where we've been doing some work. We've had in other parts of the state some terrific partnerships with educational institutions. I'm hoping we can replicate that across the state. I'm hoping we can enhance some of the efforts that we're already engaged in right now and make sure that we're working together, because you really are the future of the environmental protection movement, the commitment to clean energy, the commitment of towards green jobs. Again, when we're doing this right, it's a win-win-win for everybody. The environment wins, public health wins, the economy wins. So with that, I'd like to thank you for having me. It has truly been my pleasure to be here and be part of this. I wish you all the best, and anytime we can be partners together, I'm looking forward to that work, and I thank you very much.
Hi, how are you? How's everyone doing today? Did I get your attention with the voice modification? Am I talking too loud? No? All right. My name is Tim Killalay. I'm a member of Seeds of Sustainability. I'd like to thank everyone for being here today, and especially the organizers, Professor Corbin, Elizabeth Amaral, and Shailene DePina are all people you should give a round of applause for, because they put this together and it's amazing. So the agenda for right now is a climate change panel, impacts in Massachusetts. This is especially important to me because I'm a huge beach lover. I love being on the water, and one of my great fears is losing beaches to sea level rise related to climate change. I also work with a bunch of fine people, fine volunteers from 350 South Coast. One is David Hammond. He is a advocate for social justice, economic justice, many different types of organizations Dave has been involved in. He's done a great, great job. Tremendous experience, tremendous capability, and a wealth of knowledge. Another gentleman here is John Dufresne. John is the Node's secretary. He comes from a background of working in information and recording. He's an amazing person taking notes and holding people accountable. He definitely helps me because I had a problem where I was I didn't tell everyone that they should have been here early, so that's my fault for missing out on a couple of the volunteers. However, we're going to get started on the impacts of climate change in Massachusetts. We have a list of questions, and our panelists are going to, you know, answer in their best knowledge. Another of our volunteers is, might want to come up. If not, it's totally cool. We'll start off with the questions. Hey, Pam, come on up. You want to come on up? Okay. So the first question is, we'll have them introduce each other, introduce themselves. Here's John.
I'm John Dufresne. I'm a native and lived most of my life in New Bedford. So everything going on in southeastern Massachusetts is very important to me, like the miracle if we ever get our South Coast Rail.
Hi, folks. I'm Dave Hammond. I've been doing this for almost 56 years. I'm really happy to be here today. Climate change is the worst threat that humanity has ever faced, and we need to get on top of it by yesterday.
So one of the first questions that we have that I'd love to have them answer is, what makes you worried about climate change? This is climate change can be a personal thing, you know? What can people lose is sort of the thing that we're curious about, and how can we prevent that from happening? And especially related to the South Coast, to our homes, what makes you worried about climate change and the South Coast?
Well, first of all, it's the power of these storms. These hurricanes are getting much more powerful. You're getting things like Superstorm Sandy will be a much more constant event. And then there's the economic and health effects. First of all, I have two siblings that have asthma, and it's getting much more difficult with them with the increasing of the carbon gases. And there's much more people being born with asthma and other breathing disorders.
I'm involved with this movement because I have 6 grandchildren, and I want them to have a shot at a decent future. Climate change is rapidly approaching a tipping point. That will happen when all the methane sequestered in the tundra gets released due to warming. We face a runaway climate catastrophe at that point. We may be... Can you hear me now? A little bit better. Okay. Yeah, as I was saying, climate change is approaching a tipping point where all the sequestered methane will be released into the atmosphere. Methane is a much more powerful greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. We have to turn around our use of fossil fuels. We have to bring the atmospheric concentrations of carbon dioxide down below 300 parts per million by the end of this century. And I'm devoting all my effort, all my time, since I'm retired, to this cause.
So for those of you that don't understand all of the science behind it, there are a lot of factors going on. One of those is that there are gases called methane that are stored in the frozen parts of our world, the tundra. Those get released as the tundra melts, as it gets warmer. And the whole idea of carbon gases in the air, that is, if you think of a million parts of our air, how many parts of it are made of carbon? So this is what we're talking about with the science of things. And when we think about the South Coast, we think about the coal power plant in Somerset, right across from Fall River, affecting our asthma. We think about things like that. And then you connect with that emotional part, the part that feels overwhelmed, that feels fed up. Like, what can you do to fight this, to stop it, to prevent it? What kind of action can you take? And, you know, asking these panelists what their personal motivations are is really important, because it's not just about enthusiasm, it's about fear and using enthusiasm instead to work on it. So next question that I have for our panelists is, what made you join 350 South Coast? What made you join 350 Mass, which is an organization that seeks to prevent carbon gases from taking up more space in our air?
Well, first motivation was back when Jimmy Carter was president, and he put solar panels on the roof of the White House, making a statement that we should move to add additional energy that's from the sun, that's the most powerful source of energy in our solar system. And then President Reagan came in, and the first thing he does is take them right off the roof. Well, then in 2001, Dr. James Hansen, who is one of the best climatologists in the world, had a PBS special talking about 6 degrees Celsius from getting the point where there's no going back with our modern technology from the climate change, where the storms will be, instead of talking about category fours and fives, they can be category seven storms. So I wanted to do something to make change, and the only thing I could do before that was sign petitions. And last year I signed a petition, and it happened to be one that was connected to 350 Mass. I didn't know, and I was contacted by Marlon, who is the founder of our node, and he asked us about joining, my brother and I, and that's when we joined last February.
I really liked what I saw when I first came across 350 Mass. They are a grassroots organization in the truest sense of the word. They have nodes all over the state. They work on local issues, and they are very, very effective in what they do. Other organizations tend to dig down into a particular issue, like pipelines, stopping the spread of pipelines that we don't need. 350 Mass focuses on the big picture, and we tackle everything that is contributing to, well, what used to be called global warming. I think now it's more appropriate to call it catastrophic climate destruction. And since we've got that guy in the White House, our job is now critically important. So I would like to invite all of you out there to check us out. Our table's right over there. And see if you feel that you can make a difference in working with us.
So we've identified that there is a lot of concern for climate change. There is a lot of concern for where we're going as a country, as a community, as a world. We understand that there are avenues out there to make a difference, to make change. Not only 350 Mass, but there are other intersectional organizations that you can find a purpose with Coalition for Social Justice, the Hero Movement, a lot of the other organizations here. The important thing is to feel like you're making an impact, even in the South Coast. One of our volunteers I met first through city cleanup in Fall River. This volunteer was an amazing person. We had a city cleanup on the waterfront, and Pam was the toughest cleaner out there. At one point, she was under the boardwalk pulling out a mattress and a rug and dragging it across the rocks every, like 50 feet. Like, that's an impact right there. That's a small impact, but that's something that you can do by joining an organization, taking the time to organize yourself, to lead. The next question for my two panelists is, how do you feel you make an impact, and what is the reason for that impact? How does it make you feel?
Well, a significant impact that we accomplished last year with our movement, we did a march down the length of what would be the latest pipelines that Spectra wants to build, and got the word out that there was going to be a gas tax. All of us were going to pay for their private industry to put their gas lines in, even though the Attorney General had a private research done that says we don't need any more natural gas. We have enough already in the system to do it. Well, as a result of it being exposed, it went to the Supreme Court in Massachusetts, and the Supreme Court justices agree with us. They said that we, the private citizens, should not be paying for private industry. And this year, we've got inspired them to put a bill on for gas tax, to force the gas companies to fix all the leaks in the gas. This was accomplished down in Texas 3 years ago when they put it in, and 2 years after they made it into law, all the leaks in the pipelines in Texas are fixed. There's no more.
I feel like I'm making a significant impact in working with 350 Mass because we are effective both in working with the state legislature and in putting direct pressure on the fossil fuel industry. My family has been supporting progressive causes now for 247 years, and I am very, very thankful to be able to carry on that tradition. And because the issue of climate change is so important, I feel that anything and everything that I can do personally will make a difference. It has to make a difference. If my family is to flourish through the next several generations, we have got to bring carbon dioxide concentrations back down below 280 parts per million. The name 350 Mass comes from what was considered to be a serious tipping point. 350 parts per million of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has triggered the sea level rise that we are beginning to be able to measure all over the world. And right now, that concentration is at 420 parts per million. If it goes much higher, the poles will warm to the point where they'll substantially lose their ice caps. And we will experience a sea level rise, not of inches, but of feet. And that would be a terrible catastrophe for over half the world's population. So any little thing that I can do, any big thing I can do, to me is worth it.
When we talk about impact, there's a lot of different ways to make it. You can run a business, you can follow your dreams. Almost anything can be related to preventing climate change in different ways. Does your business have sustainable packaging? Does it focus on recycling and composting and creating less waste, using less energy, and creating food that is healthy and contributes to what they call carbon sequestration? When we think of agriculture, these are plants that are actively taking carbon out of the air. When you're part of a solar panel community garden, or you decide to put solar panels on your house, you're actively fighting climate change. And there's new finance methods that allow you to either own those rights or for another company to manage that. You can speak to any of the organizations around here for that. You can work on social or economic justice issues which are uniquely linked to climate change. With the Marion Institute Coalition for Social Justice, the Hero Movement. You can buy and support green businesses. You can recycle. There are a million different ways to make an impact, and that is the best part. Because it's not just about climate change, it's about water health, it's about our outdoor spaces, it's about our own health. And when it comes down to it, it's about your own impact. So please feel free to stop by any of the organizations or the businesses here today, learn a little bit, network, and come back next year, because we plan on having it again. So I'd like to thank all of our panelists. Does anyone have any questions today? I'd also like to thank some of our 350 Mass volunteers who are here playing in roles just as important. Pam and Rita, thank you very much. They're busy manning the floor, personing the floor. And I'd like to thank John and Dave. Would you like to say anything else?
I'd just like to run through a few of the things that you can do starting tonight. The most important thing, I think, for every individual here, turn off your television. Not because you're going to save that little bit of electricity it uses. Do it to save your mind. Do it to free your mind, to open your mind, to be able to think. Another thing that you can do is walk. Ride a bike. Leave your car at home whenever you can. Take public transportation. A third thing, if you are a renter like I am, start to pester your landlord about installing solar panels, joining a community wind farm or a community solar farm. If you're a homeowner, get those panels installed. If you're so inclined, march with us. We need to put many more boots on the ground in this struggle, and we need every caring, loving person out there in the streets with us. That's just a few of the things. I'm sure you can all think of many, many more. The really tough thing to do is to start. Just do it.
All right, that's it. Thank you, everyone. And up next is the solar panel. All right. Thank you very much.